us direction from above. We need a word from
the Lord. Yes, God. Amen.
Word
from the Lord. Tonight in the house.
Just one word. And give us peace.
Continue to be in prayer for our church family. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I think also God knows what we need before we get to it.
Well,
that's right.
And this month, which is July the 1st, will be designated the month of peace. The month of peace. And what is the opposite of peace?
Chaos.
Chaos. War. We can see strategically the devil wants war and chaos to break out this month. But God has already designated peace month. Say to your neighbor, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Be at peace.
Be at peace.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
The Bible says, behold, how good and pleasant it is for us to dwell in unity and harmony and in love. That sounds like peace to me.
Yeah.
And peace is a characteristic of people who conquer. During this year of God, we are studying throughout this whole year the fruit of the Spirit and any derivative of the fruit of the Spirit. Last month was joy. This month is peace. And we're going to be abiding in the peace of God this month. Amen?
Amen.
Tonight's lesson is entitled, The Peace of God. The Peace of God. And we're going to be looking at Philippians chapter 4. Verses 6 through 9. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 9. I want you all to read this together on three. This is the NIV. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 9. Let's read this together on three. One, two, three.
Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God.
And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me,
put it in prayer,
and the God of peace will be with you.
Amen. Amen. Again, we're talking about tonight the peace of God. The peace of God, which is the title of that painting there. And tonight we're going to be looking at in the text. We're going to be looking at the prayer in the text. We're going to be looking at the peace in the text. And we're going to be looking at the practice in this text. We want you to know tonight that Christians should pray to God for peace.
Well,
Christians should pray to God for peace. Say to your neighbor, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Pray for the peace of Bethlehem.
Pray for the peace of Bethlehem.
Say to your other neighbor, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Pray for the peace.
Pray for the peace
of Bethlehem.
Of Bethlehem.
And you know why.
And you know why.
And you know why. Again, the opposite of peace is war. And if you look at any of many of the warring nations, you will see that they are nations that are not prosperous because there is no peace. If you look at any church that is battling you will see that there is no, well, there is no peace in that church. There's no prosperity in that church. You see, at any company where they're battling with one another, you'll see that in the company where there is no peace, there is no prosperity. And if you ask somebody whether you want war or peace or prosperity, most people will choose prosperity even over peace, but you need peace before you can prosper. Hello?
All right.
So in this text, we're going to talk about the peace of God, which we need as a church, which you need in your family, which you need at your job, which you need in your marriage. Hello? A marriage lacking peace is a couple that's bickering and arguing all the time. Hello?
Real?
Can't get along over anything. Just arguing mad over every little thing. And you get a person in that family who has no peace with inside him or herself, they will always be battling against you no matter what you do. You can dot every I and every cross every T, and they'll make up something to battle about. If you're married to a person that doesn't have any peace in their hearts, there I say peace is important. It has to be important because it's considered a part of the fruit of the Spirit.
Amen.
It's one of those few characteristics in which God says is symbolic of a true Christian.
Yeah.
Young man I know of, every church he's ever been in, he's always had a problem with leadership. Always wanting to meet and try to solve the issues. There's only one problem. He's the only one with the issues. He's wasting everybody else's time. Acting like he really wants peace when in his heart there is war. These kind of people, they can waste your day, waste your time, but you don't waste time with people like that. If you see somebody that has never been a part of a team, anybody in here that's been a part of a team sport, never been successfully, we'll say, a part of a team. Because you be a part of a team, but not be successful. Or be a part of a church, but not be successful because you can't get along with nobody. And you think everybody else has a problem. Have you ever seen those kind of people?
Oh,
yeah. Can't get along with nobody and think everybody else is the problem. Wait a minute. Maybe the problem is you.
Yeah.
Maybe the problem is you. And maybe you need to pray for the peace of God. You don't have to fight for everything. Matter of fact, you're supposed to let God fight your battles anyway.
Yeah.
Hello? I know many of you had it hard, and you had to try to make it on your own, and you pulled yourself up by your own bootstraps. Maybe you wouldn't have had it so hard if you'd allowed God to fight your battles. Hello? So we're going to pray tonight for the peace of God. And the first thing you'll see for people who do not have peace is that they are anxious. And that they don't pray. Prayerlessness leads to anxiety.
Well.
Prayerlessness leads to anxiety.
On the sea, but what we need is a special word that will burn within our heart and give us direction from above.